Clifton Suspension Bridge. Although not one of the earliest suspension bridges in England, it must yet have appeared a miracle while it was built, owing to the giddy height of the gorge and the daring with which the span was bridged without any intermediate support. The Clifton Bridge might also claim the title of being the most beautiful of early English suspension bridges. That is largely due to the felicitous design of the stone pylons. They are of rubble below, but of light ashlar right at the top. And the parabolic opening above the square-headed one is again a very happy motif. The vertical cables are wonderfully light, and so the job of supporting the carriageway safely is done not only with daring, but also with grace.
Pevsner, like many modernists, was initially attracted to Victorian engineering structures, which were hardly considered architecture when they were built. It was only later that he came to appreciate the ransacking of past styles, a process he called historicism.
There he was, advocating the pure style of the Bauhaus, the style established by Walter Gropius in 1914, which was forever. On the other hand, he clearly loved the 19th century. He loved the 18th century. I mean, he loved aspects of the Middle Ages. He loved mannerism. But particularly with the 19th century, its richness and its looking back to the past, he was quite happy with. It was the zeitgeist telling him, it would seem, what he ought to like. But one feels that the real Pevsner, who felt so happy in Britain, like the Victorians.
He was highlighting architects that had been forgotten or not appreciated. I mean, we have to remember, if you go back to the time when he started writing, that anything Victorian was considered to be rubbish, be it pictures, be it buildings. We know that churches such as this often were whitewashed. I mean, people said they're dark, they're gloomy, nobody got the point. This is probably one of the 20 great churches of London.
I think Pevsner's achievement with regard to the 19th century was to make the English take it really seriously. Here was Pevsner again, telling England, indeed Britain, what was worthwhile, what some of the greatest achievements were.
I think it's possible that Pevsner himself was not as keen on Victorian architecture as he sometimes says in the books. You get the sort of sense that, you know, maybe he felt, because there was so much of it in Britain, that he kind of had to appreciate it. And this may just be me talking, but it's interesting what he said about Keble College when finally he came to review Keble College in Oxford, and Oxfordshire was one of the last books that he did. We were all waiting with bated breath to see what he actually said about Butterfield's great masterpiece. He said it was greatly to be commended, but he actually said it was ugly. And I wonder what he really thought of a church like this. I reckon he understood its importance, but whether he really liked it, that I don't know.
It's interesting, I think, the contrast between his attitude to the 19th century, or, for that matter, his attitude to the 18th, because he had a great enthusiasm for Hawksmoor and Vanbrugh and for the more extreme expressions of Baroque, and yet he didn't like the extreme expressions of brutalism, of what he called aggressive architecture in the 20th century, which he felt somehow was not appropriate for what he felt architects ought to be doing at that time.
There is a profound irony about Pevsner's attitude towards the architecture of the last 25 years of his lifetime. The great modernist came to dislike modernism. He wanted the international style of the 20s and 30s to last forever, to be frozen in stasis. He was a progressive who came to hate progress.
Pevsner's view of modern architecture is sometimes curious. He, of course, started with this belief that modern architecture was an absolute. Later, he became very irritated when modern architects, obviously wanting to experiment, deviated from that view. And so in the 1960s, he couldn't bear the new historicism, he called it.
A good many of the most recent buildings don't appeal to me. I found they're brutal, they're aggressive, they're piling concrete on concrete. My architecture is glass and steel, if possible, with, you know, a minimum of material and a maximum of performance. And this is no longer really topical.
Chester, County Police Headquarters, 1964-7, by the county architect Edgar Tabernacle. Extremely objectionably sited. An eight-story block immediately by the propylaea of the castle, and turning towards it a windowless wall with an aggressive all-over concrete relief by W.G. Mitchell. Here is a perfect piece of architecture. It has a consistent plan, and every detail is meticulously worked out. Self-discipline is its message, expressed in terms of a geometry pervading the whole and the parts, and felt wherever one moves or stops.
Pevsner did not come to dislike everything that was built in the 1960s and 70s. But one can't help but wonder whether his extravagant praise for St. Catherine's College, Oxford, he called it a perfect piece of architecture, was not prompted as much by his gratitude at finding at that date a work of which he approved as by its intrinsic worth. His long description of it is characteristic. Like the supreme literary modernist Alain Robbe Grier, Pevsner piles detail upon detail to achieve an opacity which prevents the reader from actually seeing the object that is being described. Arne Jacobsen, the Danish architect of St. Catherine's, designed everything: the chairs, the door handles, the lights, the cutlery. This achieves a certain homogeneity. This is total design at work, an ideal of Pevsner's since his Birmingham days.
Another example of, I think, the weakness and here absurdity of this totalitarian view of the package out of which you can't opt is when he was researching industrial design in the 1930s, he made a special investigation into the design of Cadbury's chocolate boxes, particularly those popular at Christmas. And he said that the English were quite irresponsible in their approach to buying chocolate boxes. They chose boxes with pictures of hunting scenes or of gondolas, instead of choosing boxes that were designed to be in harmony with the clean, simple, and bright factories in which the chocolates were made. So he said that neither still lifes nor circus scenes have a logical and understandable relationship to chocolate. So you see, there is the spirit of the age, and everyone must conform to that.